Hi, I'm Sean Romo, Senior Staff Archaeologist with Jamestown Rediscovery. Welcome back to another episode of Dig Deeper. In our last video, we introduced you to our excavations going on right outside the historic church tower here at Jamestown. Now, we uncovered a lot of interesting artifacts there, and today, we're going to go into our lab and have one of our curators, Leah Stricker, take a look at those artifacts and tell us a little bit more about what we found.
Hi everyone, I'm Leah Stricker, curator here at Jamestown, and we're here in our wet lab. This is where the artifacts come first from the field, and you can see some washing sinks behind me, so that's where our artifacts get washed. I'm here with Sean, and he's just brought in some artifacts from the field, from the different layers that they're excavating in the unit in front of the tower outside. So the material we have here in the first tray we're going to look at is from layer B. And what we can see already, we've dumped the whole bag of artifacts out that they found outside. What we can see already is a lot of architectural material. I see a lot of nails in here, which makes sense for being in front of the church tower. And also some material that is from the 17th century, but it's mixed with more modern material. So let's take a closer look at what we have in the tray. So like you can see back here, we have a lot of iron nails. We like to call those affectionately fried chicken because they look a little rusted. We have some faunal material, animal bone, some tobacco pipes. In this tray up here, what we can see is a lot of staples. So these are probably from landscaping work that was going on in the area. We have some relatively modern bottle glass. This has some letters on it, including we've spotted a USA, so definitely a little bit more modern than the 17th century. Also some window leads that indicate that the material from this layer isn't from the earliest fort period, because window leads weren't used in that early fort period. But we do also have this really cool glass print and some Delftware, which is what indicates that this is a mixed context, because these two items probably do date to the 17th century.
So we actually brought in a few different contexts for you to take a look at. And we have one right over here that's layer D, which is both an earlier historic layer, and it's actually below B. So we should have some more intact material in there.
Cool. Ooh.
Yeah, we got some nice stuff in here. But there's a lot more.
Dump carefully.
Yes.
Cool. There's a lot of stuff in here.
Yeah. Yeah, we were kind of surprised we got so many artifacts out of D. But that's good for us, because maybe we can figure out a little bit more about what's going on out there.
Yeah, it looks like there's a little bit more variety in this layer in terms of the different types of artifacts that we have. And also it looks like we're seeing some differences maybe in time period between layer B and layer D. Ooh, awesome. Very cool.
Yeah, it's a roofing tile.
Yeah, so this hole that you see here in the roofing tile would have been how you would adhere the tile to the roof of your building. That's pretty cool. And I see you have lots of tobacco pipe fragments, including this really tiny one, which is awesome. That's very cool. And you've also got a local pipe as well.
Yes. Yeah, we thought that was really neat to find in the field.
Yeah.
You can tell local pipes from European-made pipes because of the color of the fabric. So a lot of times the Chesapeake pipes are actually much more red or brown. We've also got some really thin pieces of window glass.
Yeah.
Again, makes sense being out right outside a building.
Yep, goes along with the window lead that you'd find. And you've also got some really interesting ceramics that I don't see over here in this upper layer. We've got some really pretty, this is a ceramic from North Devon. I wonder, have you guys tried to mend these two pieces? These are the same type of ceramic, so it's possible that they go together.
So we haven't tried to mend those two, but I know that this one actually does mend to a piece we found in a post hole cutting through the deposit.
Oh, cool.
Yeah.
That's awesome. I've also got a nice piece of a stoneware. This looks like Frecken stoneware. That's the ware type that our Bartman jugs, our very recognizable Bartman jugs, are made out of. So this very well could be part of a Bartman jug.
You guys probably also remember from earlier, we've got our wine bottle fragments. Both of these are bases, and you can see this one's pretty sizable.
Yeah, and wine bottles change over time. The way that they were made changes over time, and also the form that they take changes over time, partly due to that change in manufacturing technique. So as you can see on this base piece, we have quite a bit of it intact still. You can see part of the body of the wine bottle coming up here on the sides, and you can also see this part in the middle, which is what's called the kick. And it's the shape and height of the kick and the shape of the sides that tell us that this wine bottle dates to the late 17th century.
So speaking of dating stuff, one of the things I wanted to ask you about was this material here, because it seems like it's 17th century, and maybe we could get a good date on it. Do you know what it is?
Yeah, so I've actually consulted with our senior curator about this type of ceramic. You can see that what we have here are actually some pieces that do mend together, so they fit really nicely. This is a rim fragment, so this is the very top of the vessel. And if you turn it to the side, you can tell kind of the shape of what the larger vessel would be. It looks like it would be part of a like a storage jar, something kind of pretty substantial. And one thing that our senior curator pointed out is this distinctive patterning here. And so she helped us identify this as Morgan Jones. Morgan Jones ceramics are named after Morgan Jones, who founded a kiln site, and he worked with a potter named Mr. White. Very sadly, Mr. White passed away the very same year that Morgan Jones started his pottery in 1677. However, Morgan Jones ceramics, when they're found on an archaeological site, can be very useful for dating because they were produced for such a short period of time. And you guys have mentioned that a lot of your material here is dating to kind of that time period, the later 1600s. So it makes sense that you would find a ceramic that also dates to that slightly later time period.
Yeah, and that's really great for us because we've been thinking that the burn deposit, which is actually beneath this layer, is potentially from Bacon's Rebellion period, so that's 1676. So finding something from 1677 right on top of it is actually a really great find.
Yeah, very cool. We also at Jamestown don't have a lot of ceramics of this time period in our collection. A lot of the Jamestown collection dates to the earliest fort period. So finding things like this that are slightly later are pretty exciting for us. And this piece, because it's such a nice fragment and is representative of a vessel form that we can identify in a jar, this might actually become part of our reference collection here at Jamestown.
So while we're on the topic of ceramics, I have here actually the other piece of that North Devon.
Right.
So you guys can see how it mends together.
Which one? This one?
It's actually this piece. Oh. So it goes just like that.
Oh, cool.
Yeah.
Nice.
When we get this cleaned up, we might be able to see the pattern a little more.
Okay, so now that we've washed these ceramic sherds, we can actually see a little bit more clearly the paste of the ceramic or the fabric, the decoration that's on top, and the glaze. And that's what helps us identify this as North Devon Sgraffito slipware. We can also tell that this is a dish, which is one of the most common forms of North Devon Sgraffito slipware. And so North Devon Sgraffito slipware is found at the earliest in 1622 on archaeological sites, and it disappears from the archaeological record in about 1710. And that makes sense. It is consistent with the rest of the material that we've looked at from the layer that this material was excavated from. North Devon Sgraffito slipware gets its name from the fact that it has a slip, so you can see the white of that slip peeking through, and actually on the reverse, you can see some of the slip has dripped on the back here. And sgraffito refers to the decoration that you can see throughout each of these pieces. It's always exciting for us to see the artifacts coming into the lab. So do you guys have anything else from this unit that you're ready to bring us yet?
We just finished taking out our burn deposit, the stuff that's beneath D, that maybe dates to the 1600s around Bacon's Rebellion.
Cool.
So we should have some of that coming in pretty soon.
Awesome.
So stay tuned if you want to see more from of what we found.